that are nominated, and you are nominated at this meeting.
Anybody could be nominated. Only people who attend, or you have to live, work their own property, and the mayor can be on board. Anybody could be nominated.
If you've never been to a meeting in the past year, you can still be nominated at the meeting.
Yes. But if you're looking for older people who've been.
Anyone here can nominate a candidate, whether you're voting or not, you still get the vote.
You don't, it's not as though you get one vote, per member like you do. Each nominee, everybody here gets to vote for each nominee, correct?
Everybody who's attended meeting and all that.
Right, anybody here that has a vote is able to vote on each nominee. So you appoint a person A.
The way it's generally done is first we elect the chair, and then usually we find enough people who want to be on the board.
Sure.
Is there not a possibility to petition this tonight, this ballot that's going on, so that we can all vote on it? Because there's a lot of people showing up right now that can sign a petition.
Even if they could be moved.
Absolutely, yeah. My concern is that I have a business and I live in it, and I've never received a postcard until this week. And that's why I have attended it, because I would love to be more involved.
Say exempt.
We have one at the, we have one at our house and at the business, but that was the person ever, was for this meeting, so either I, you know.
All I can tell you is that city, the neighborhood services for the city has told me, and I have not independently verified this, I have no idea. She says, Cindy Clark says that the post office sends this postcard to everybody with a mailing address in the Whiteaker. I assume that's businesses as well.
We get one as a business, we've been getting one for 6 years, and usually I recycle them. My question is, does it matter who's on the board or any of that? If most of us are here for the parking issue and for the sound ordinance, we can still be voting on those things tonight?
You can vote on those things.
Okay, so.
I don't know.
Only if you've been here for a different meeting.
No, that's just for the board.
That's just for the board.
That's just for the board.
He just said he doesn't know if those things are scheduled to be voted on.
You know, in my reading of the charter here, it doesn't specifically prohibit postponing an election.
5 years ago, we postponed an election because of something like this, and they can do it again.
Okay, then they can do it again.
Yes.
I mean, if your goal is broad participation, you guys, it's all over your minutes, you guys talk about how no one shows up.
Well, the question is, if our goal is broad participation, and you specifically come here just on the night when we're having an election, where were you the last year?
People been working, people been with their families.
You were going to take away our music.
If you set up orders long enough, that says you're going to do a noise ordinance and parking permits, eventually people will start paying attention. It just so happened.
We don't have the power to deal with noise ordinance, or the power to enforce parking. All we can do is ask the city council to investigate it, and if they decide they want to investigate it, they will hold public hearings, and as a result of those, they might be enacted.
Yeah, I'm worried about the process for it. Well, all I'm saying is not in the council bylaws, it's simply that you can't postpone an election. So it's not, it doesn't say.
We'll ask Brad Foster when he shows up.
Oh, I
feel like the one that's in the chair.
Hi, how are you, Brad? I'm the chair of this.
Brad.
Brad. I was actually hoping we could do the election like right up front, really quickly, and get him out of this.
And we can postpone the election right up front, and then use the chair to open a dialogue about what's going on in the neighborhood, because most of these people aren't eligible to vote.
How many people here have not been to a meeting in the past year?
I can't remember.
And a lot of people want to be involved.
Yeah, and how many of them want to like take on this organization and be involved in this?
I personally would like to be a member of the board and move forward and help the process and the community progress, and you know, obviously there's some concerns that I have interest in. I'd like to be on the board. However, I have not been to a meeting. I've been a business owner here in the neighborhood for 10 years, and I apologize. I wish I would have.
We can vote you on the board because you're not eligible to vote.
But we
have done it.
Yeah.
I know. How does everybody feel thinking about this. Postpone the election until the next meeting, which is September.
Postpone it before they can do it.
The bylaws say the board of directors should be elected for a one-year term, but the council membership at the annual meeting may matter.
I don't even think you have 10 here who can vote, which means you may not have.
So it's only, it just has to be by the end of the month.
Yeah, we can do it next week.
Well, the silliness too is the architect.
Next week.
Who would like to start a Whiteaker Community Council Facebook page so we all know about the other meetings, what's going on at the meeting?
I got an idea. Let's make these like flyers and stuff and let's get a crew and I'm a part of it and let's go hand them out to everybody. I'll go down the door. I know the street.
This was a function of weeks of people taking notice.
Everybody good with doing it 2 weeks?
I don't believe so. I believe that we have to have that postcard mail out and out soon.
We've got flyers going with other things. I got free to help do that?
Yeah.
Notices in the newspaper, there's no requirements for serving legally required documents. Doesn't matter to me, I don't know.
That it's going to happen, it's been done.
So some of us took off work to be here today, though.
Normally the bylaws specify a specific rule of notification. To say that in the bylaws, how the notification goes out, how the meeting.
The definition of public notice is right.
I don't think it says anything about how we notify people. We've done it different ways.
But you know, actually what the bylaws specifically say is that the only people who can vote in the annual election, which is specified as this April meeting, are anyone who's been to any one of these meetings in the last year. And here's the list of all the people.
I think what we're all trying to accomplish here
is it possible that for whatever reason, the interest of the meetings we're discussing, didn't get everybody here. We're here now, and we can't. And it seems like we'd like to vote. So you know, we could all throw our hats into the election.
Or postponing the election is that this would count for all those folks who are saying that
it's going towards the right person.
Dennis, we have to know the spirit, which is to involve those
things. And that's the way we should be.
There was a big push to take this over by the conservative party. A bunch of people showed up, and they
I've never heard about the meeting in 8 years.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, like, a non-hostile way to do it is just by putting your name down as an elected person. Everyone gets one vote, and nobody wins.
Since we weren't notified.
That's the string along. Next meeting, I'm all
there's a few ones coming along.
Hey, what's up?
So I'm going to sort of end this discussion.
I'll do all right. I'm trying to be careful.
I'm going to make a little motion.
Yeah,
I'll be very quick about it.
Hey.
So I move that we postpone the election for 2 weeks and hold it 2 weeks from tonight, same time, same place.
7 or 6:30?
7 o'clock. And 7 o'clock okay?
Yes. Yeah. Got it.
So those 7 o'clock, good for me. Tonight, whatever that date is. And everyone here sign in with Duncan so that you're like, he's got the paperwork to all the voters in 2 weeks. And some people are going to help me put out flyers in the neighborhood at the door to door, right?
Mm-hmm.
We got this many people here on Facebook. And
we all are.
No, that's great.
And I know that the councils are losing their funding for the voters pretty soon. And they were all going to the social networking anyway. So I mean, this kind of shows how effective that is.
Thank you. We have a second. Is there any further discussion?
Just
Just where the next meeting is going to take place.
It would take place right here at 7 o'clock, the 23rd, so today, 23rd.
Is there something larger? I mean, just assuming that more people will...
We could try and get the Whiteaker auditorium, the school auditorium next door.
Try it.
What we work on that.
It might, because it might definitely...
I work on that.
If we can get that, we'll put a notice on the door here.
Also, the other issues that I think a lot of us were assuming there was going to be a vote about tonight, I guess to get some potential energy behind the noise ordinance and some of these parking things, can that those discussions also be postponed until after the election?
Maybe we should ask what was on.
You know, what was the agenda?
Yeah, we as a community can postpone that for 2 weeks if that's the sense of the community. Is that kind of like...
Yeah.
I'd have to have more information about that as well.
We think tonight's going to be quick and easy. It's like sign in, dump in your email, tell me if you'll help me put these flyers out.
Let's go.
We'll make them up and I'll contact you.
We'll come back.
And then we'll do it like next week, 2 weeks.
I would like, it would be nice because there's a lot of questions going around about this noise ordinance that's been in works for about a year. And so maybe it could come out of your guys' mouths, the information you've been collecting, and what the end goal is.
Okay.
I can answer
that. All right, so first let's put this thing to a vote. Are we good with that? Okay, so all in favor of doing the meeting in 2 weeks that we were going to do tonight, basically, is what we're at. Hands up? All right, that's kind of done. All right, now.
Thank you.
You want us to give you a background of where things are with the proposed noise ordinance?
All of us, yes.
Okay.
I can answer that because I was just talking to code enforcement last night about it. You know, we don't have an objective decibel in the noise ordinance, so it's totally subjective. Whatever side you're on, there's a lot of kind of argument and subjectivity about it. So if Portland has an objective decibel level in the noise ordinance, I think it's 60 or 55 decibels at the property line, but Ashland has it, Medford has it, a lot of communities have it, so Eugene has it. So that's the proposal, is to prevail on the city council if they would just simply put an objective decibel level right in the noise ordinance. And then there's no argument. If you're over the decibel level, you are. If you're not, you're not. You know, and it just takes the argument and subjectivity right out of it. So that's why we were proposing that as a good idea. Yeah.
So would that create then more bureaucracy as far as like bars having to apply for permits to have live music just based on decibel level?
I'd just like to point out that 60
is
a decibel
number
right now.
Also, I'd like to point out, as per your question that you were just talking about there, the permits that people get for outdoor events like Block Party or some of the stuff we do at the arcade and back there, somewhere on the permit, it says that whatever it is you're doing is subject to the ordinance of the city. So at the same time that it's signing a permit saying, yes, you can have live music, they're also saying that it has to be done by 10 and that it has to be, you know,
exactly
what they're trying to create. It's just a new thing, which effectively makes it impossible.
One
thing that the city does have a provision for allowing events to go forward without any violating noise.
Right.
My name is Scott Feldman. I'm a lieutenant with the Eugene Police, and I'm currently assigned day watch Sunday through Wednesday, and I'm the point person for the U.S. Society of Eugene Issues of Finance Committee. I think we have some technically noticed for 7, but this is amazing. So, just a quick, very brief primer on the city's noise ordinance for the pieces that I think you guys are concerned about. The standard as it is right now is it disturbs a reasonable person of normal sensitivities. Please don't ask me to define it. Because it is as subjective as it sounds, and it's been that way for a very, very long time. The other interesting thing about it is that it is not time specific. It's any time of the day or night that those activities are happening. So there's no time limit to it. It can be the middle of the day and your stereo is thumping and your neighbor can't sleep and they work a night shift and they can't sleep and they call us to enforce it. The police can't enforce it. We usually start with a warning, but we can write tickets and make arrests for it. When the city issues a permit, I think somebody said this, for an event. Say you have a concert, you get it permitted, and you're allowed to have a particular area with a particular set of activities from a certain time until another certain time, that is in effect a waiver of the noise ordinance. And it can be pretty frustrating for people who are bothered by the event, but once the city permits the event, it's there. The most extreme example from history was, did anybody go to see U2 when they were up?
I heard it.
Yeah, I was there. That was the pop art tour.
And because I think we'll get another laugh out of this, I happened to be in the comm center that night, and we got a complaint from somebody out in Bonita. Not making this up. And they said, we want to file a noise complaint when the sheriff's out here because our neighbors have a live band in the backyard and they're keeping us up. And the call taker said, no, that's not a band in your neighbor's backyard. It's you two at Austin here in Eugene. Silence on the phone. No, really, go outside and look and see. Well, they are playing YouTube sounding song.
Oh my God.
So that's the. Those are the very basics for the types of events that you're talking about, as far as the noise ordinance goes right now. So if it's a permanent event, that's considered a waiver from the city for the duration of that event, for that permitted noise.
But there is a time limit to that, is there not?
There usually is a time limit in the event permit that says, you know, you're permitted to have this event from this time until this time. You're always asked to stop when the permit ends, because the waiver eventually is gone by the time the permit.
For those in at 10 p.m., you can't get a waiver after 10 p.m. anyway.
I don't know that there's necessarily a limit.
I don't
make those decisions, so don't quote me on that part. So it's often 10 or so, but I think it could be a little.
This is the existing noise ordinance.
Correct.
That we are all currently functioning under.
Yeah, raise your hands if you've never gotten a noise complaint.
Never.
Yeah, never got a noise complaint. But they don't know how the noise ordinance works.
Does the city have the equipment to measure this, or is this something that once it's in place?
It's a $5,000 piece of equipment.
It's not that expensive. But
I bought the equipment.
Yeah. There's an app for that.
Hey, he wants to say something back there now.
So to answer the question really quickly about how loud it is in the equipment, we can buy a sound pressure level meter, but there are complicated things when you deal with noise. How many of you in the night have been far, far away from the tracks but heard the train?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. The story I just told you about Bonita, that's a true story. We've gone to noise complaints where right next to the house where the stereos go boom, 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 you can barely hear it. But inside the neighbor's house at the end of the block, where it's insulated from a lot of the other background noise in the neighborhood, it's resonating in there and it's really, really loud. And so where do you measure from and how do you measure is a difficult thing to establish. And do you wake up the audio engineers in the room? Do you measure A weighted or C weighted, because one measures a flat sound spectrum and one is weighted for more of the range where human ears hear, but you can be pretty annoyed by low frequency sounds. So I'm not advocating one or the other, just telling you that having to actually go out and measure sound is a challenging thing. Like what you're talking about is the quality of life impact of that noise on your kids being able to sleep or you being able to sleep or enjoying trouble.
Okay, so a follow-up question to that then is, for existing venues then, would they have to apply for a noise permit pretty much, or a
different night?
Like every night that they want to have music, or is it just for like a period of time, like can you do like for a whole year, like say you're a bar, you're a venue, can you do a blanket permit for the whole year? Or is it like how much is this going to cost these establishments to be putting out towards to have live music at their venues?
That's an interesting question. I'm afraid I don't know the answer to that. I know we don't currently permit the bars to make noise. If doors get left open, like at Wild Hall, for example, we do occasionally go and make sure the people close the doors. But I'm not aware of us, and please don't hold me to this because it could have happened, I'm not aware of us ever going to a bar and citing them for noise if they're making a reasonable effort to keep their doors closed and
have
any kind of normal business. But not to say that you couldn't have to at some point.
Yeah.
But I don't think that issue's ever really been addressed.
Okay.
What are the proposed changes? That's just all like the current stuff, but I'm curious about what these changes are.
I don't want it to be your
turn. We just suggested that the city adopt the same noise ordinance that Portland and Ashland and Bedford have. and they have certain decibel levels depending a little bit on time of day, and it's on, you know, whether it's at your property line, and if it's a residence, you know, whether the noise is coming from another residence, from a business, from an industrial source, whatever.
And it's over the opportunity for...
Well, it's not a lot of bureaucracy, you just have to have a sound meter and measure it to say, well, is this conform or not?
Which is also creating a new department to handle that noise.
It costs money.
How did it come about, though? I mean, is this something that has been manifesting over time, or it's all of a sudden there's a lot more noise, or...
Well, if you come to some of the meetings over the last year or so, we had some meetings about noise,
Yes, that's what I'm asking. Sorry,
you don't like it.
On the flyer like that, it didn't say a time or a place.
That was my fault.
Okay.
Microsoft publisher to publish their stuff.
Okay, so normally you'll say one night where we...
It's always 7 o'clock here.
So pardon me for a second, I'm still unclear on what the difference is going to be with the new ordinance versus what we're already under, and that's the same question that she just asked, but I'm unclear still. You just said...
The difference is that the city would have to enact the ordinance. At first, they're going to have all sorts of public meetings and they'll stretch for years, but what we're asking is that there be a specific noise level that you can actually measure rather than a she said kind of a thing where it's too loud. No, it isn't.
They can
pass whatever the hell they want. I don't know.
Right, just to clearly define a level, versus a very nebulous...
If you put your email address on the sign-in sheet, I will email you some stuff I snatched off the internet with portions of the Ashland and the Portland noise.
Right. I looked those up, but yeah.
If the city would have to, form a noise enforcement office, would it be regular police? Would it be through regular city code enforcement? I mean, what kind of equipment would they have to buy? What kind of training procedures would they have to take? This is a complicated system. I've been reading up on it.
So currently, and I oversimplified the noise ordinance a little bit, I believe there are some things in city code, and you should, for the meeting next week, we can talk about this more, bring a copy of the noise ordinance in so people can read through it. For certain types of noise, hello. sorry, distracted by the little... For certain things like air conditioners and equipment, there are some more specific, noise categories in the current ordinance. Those are enforced by code enforcement. The one that I was talking about is the criminal noise statute, which prohibits also construction noise past certain times of day, in addition to the general noise issue, and that's the part that the police deal with. So how it would be enforced if the law was changed is entirely up to how the law gets written and where that responsibility gets set. If it gets set up as a civil penalty, it's probably going to be code enforcement. If it gets set up as a crime or a law violation, criminal violation, then it will probably be police. As to expense, a couple of good quality sound pressure level meters isn't going to cost very much. The training to use them is, in my experience, probably 5 or 10 minutes, so I don't think a lot of it's necessary.
Doesn't part of these like recorders, though, if they can't hear someone in the attic?
I actually feel very strongly about this issue in that people shouldn't bother other people with unusual amounts of noise, but to have some police interaction problem is worse, you know, and somehow there has to be like a real balance between those two, and leaving the police out of it completely, but people talking about, you know, if you have a problem, say something. Right. Most of the time, that will cure the problem.
Yeah, ask your neighbor, just going to knock on the door and say, hey, can you turn the music down?
It's still going to be complaint-driven, except there's going to be a finite end to it, so that if whoever is bothered by a particular show at a particular bar, whatever, calls in and says, I want to complain about the noise, and he goes down there and checks it out, now he puts a sound meter up to it and says, you guys got to shut it down. versus in the past, it would, he would come by and say, yeah, it's kind of loud. Somebody over there is complaining. When do you guys think you're going to be done? Okay, try and wrap it up, keep it down. And then there would be a conversation about it. I think we all want for that conversation to happen here, you know, and for the people that are actually having problems with what's going on, and one by one figure out solutions. And I know that there's people that have specific issues with specific areas of the Whiteaker. It doesn't need to be a big blanket.
One clarification. Yes, clarification to what you said. It wouldn't be they'd be asked to shut it down. They'd be asked to turn it down.
Sure, but at the levels that, you know, the Portland one that
I used. A reasonable level, and that's a reasonable.
Right.
Level.
I mean, and then.
Well, that's
fine and reasonable.
Exactly. That's where our objectivity is, and so that's why that if we had an objective level in there.
Well, that objective level is still subjective.
The level that most of us are here to protect is right. Still going to bother people.
Yeah, yes, yeah.
We want to do it better. We want to communicate more, and we want to make it easier each time it comes around. And we all want to, you know, lend a hand to make, you know, to keep the Whiteaker what it is. This is a big deal for a lot of people in the Whiteaker.
Just add one thing. We're talking about changing the noise ordinance, and the thing that this board has been talking about is adding in a specific, you know, objective standard. But that doesn't mean it can't also change to say, look, there are certain times, like Thursday through Sunday night or whatever, that venues have to be allowed to make a louder level of noise out to a certain hour. I mean, nobody wants to hear it at 8 a.m.
Sure.
But at 10 o'clock, you know, I don't care. But, this is where it's really what everyone would do it. We keep opening the discussion about having an objective standard so it doesn't become, you know, someone really disturbed by it, and it is quite loud, but it doesn't bother me. I don't know if you can see it.
It also stops the person who's not really that loud. Right. You go, well, it's not that loud, and they come out and check it.
In fact, we did actually have a resident come to us and say that her neighbor was really, really loud all the time. It was about to hear the sound meter.
I think it's a reasonable proposition, but to keep it reasonable, right? It's a decimal level. And to have musicians and other people who are, you know, have some knowledge and get on the discussion and decide. Because it would be great to say, oh, because we have 200 decimals at your property line. Yeah. But to say you're at your property line, you know, like you just have a car in your backyard with 20 friends and that's going to go under 60.
You're here. Right. I have a resident in your car.
There's got to be logical reason.
Yeah, and the whole thing is this is just the start. The city decides to investigate it. We said, hey, here's the level that Portland and Ashland use. They can make up their minds to do something else while we get the hell, I don't know. It'll be a public process and will probably take 5 years.
What
can find.
Listen, we have a paper.
I will email it. You can send it to our email address. But the lowest level was like 55 decibel at your property line of a residence after 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock. It went down 5 decibel at that time. Yeah. Well, yeah, if you're trying to go to sleep at 11 o'clock,
and don't confuse the level of the sound at its origin with the level of the sound like in your house.
Right. You know, you're measuring the sound at the site of the complaint.
Yeah, something's in your house at 70 decibels. You're going to have some help sleeping. But, you know, but the pan playing 70 decibels, people are like, you know, so it's a never thing.
So, are we going to just use this meeting to sign everybody up and go to a 2 weeks out meeting, or are we going
to... Yes, I believe that.
Let's go back here and then over to you.
I just want to make one quick point. We're talking about the ordinance, and we really haven't gotten into the parking thing yet. But I myself, and I think a lot of us have an interest to do special events that are held annually, maybe once, twice, three times a year. And we want the right to be able to kind of extend beyond the normal ordinance or the normal time, be able to go to not just 10 but midnight and really have a kick butt show and concert that that I think benefits the community, brings a lot of people in, and then, which also creates a parking issue that we need to talk about, but brings a lot of money into the local businesses, and it, it puts the neighborhood more on the map, and I think is part of what makes the neighborhood unique and...
Well, that's what Scott said. You get a permit, the city north, Northwood, it's out.
Which, but I mean, like...
We do get permits every year, but I'm just saying, there are gonna be some of those situations that are going to, even if an ordinance is put in place, like you're saying, in Portland and Ashland, I'm hoping that everyone will be on board to understand that there's, yes, once in a while, we're gonna have some really cool events for live music and food and...
Another thing about that is just that we have been doing that for 6 years, and I've...
Like, every day.
Been around that, but we also, we've also done a hand-to-hand letter to all the houses around us, as many as we can. Anyone that's came to us and says, we'd like to come to the event, we're a neighbor, we've given them a ticket, we've let them in for free. If somebody comes and complains about noise or complains about parking, we've done what we can to move people out of their parking spot. We've personally done that. So, I mean, I think that's a good example of what could happen in this community if we all were to follow that example for events and other things.
Okay, so Jerry Sauber, and what's your...
Okay. I've been on the council for a year, and half of our meetings have been concerned parking, and the other half have been concerned sound, okay, noise. And we had the council person here, Claire, and at that time I said, what do we need to do? And really, she really said, we need to have some evidence. And I volunteered to go around and take readings, and then they can present that to Claire, and then she can present it to the council. You have to do that. You just can't complain that there's noise. You have to have evidence to it.
What are your findings?
I'm sorry? No, it's during the summer is the worst time, correct?
Yes.
Why would I do it in the winter? And by the way, we just reached 110 decibels. Okay. Devils!
So now comments are out of line too.
All right, Simon.
So my basic take on the noise and the parking is that I love living in the winter, and if it's not louder than the train, it's not loud to me. Right? Yeah. But I'm not the only person in the neighborhood. I when I first got on the council, I was thinking, why are people complaining about all this? I heard from a woman who lives near Nicosi, and the smell of the beer makes her sick all the time. She's lived in that house for 18 years, and all of a sudden she can't stand living in her house anymore. And then, I hear from people who have their elderly parents come live with them and now can't deal with the party house next door. And what I figured about this whole noise ordinance is that if we could get enough people involved in writing, maybe we'd fight about it for a while, but eventually we'd come up with something that worked, and maybe worked better than what was on the books for the whole city. And it could be a real proud moment for the WIT, but it's probably going to take a long time. And I know interest levels can flag over time. I'm not running for the board. I'm in break from all this. I've got other things on my plate right now. It's awesome to see all you people here. And I hope a lot of you actually come and be part of making this neighborhood great again. Seriously.
You can see it. Don't really let a fire on our butt.
Yeah, and Tracy, what I want to say is that there's, the Portland noise ordinance has been copied by a lot of cities across the country, and it's, there are good things about it and there are bad things about it. If there is momentum from the city, the larger city, for our noise ordinance, we need to make sure that we have a seat at the table when they're working out the details. Because the devil's in the details, the people who it affects, the club owners, the live music owners, need to be present when that's being decided, instead of the day after it gets voted in saying, oh, well, this is going to ruin my business, and that's the important thing. And it may go forward, it may not, but at least by participating, we'll have the people who it affects and the people who are most knowledgeable about it will be the ones creating the policy, because there's nothing, bad policies are easy to agree, it happens all the time, but good policy, you know, takes work like that, but it can't actually make things better for everybody. And I know a lot of people just, you know, the reaction is like, noise ordinance, no way, you know, fingers in the air, and, you know, that's the sentiment right now, but if, you know, if club owners and people like that get on board and we actually come up with a good proposal, and if it's good, it'll be obvious, you know, that it's good, and then there might actually be some support for it then. But, you know, regardless, we have people here tonight talking about it, which really, if more people get together to talk about their problems, we wouldn't have laws and restrictions, because there's fees that go along with it, there's costs that go along with it, there's costs to the city. You know, Portland can't afford to enforce their noise ordinances. Beaverton is waiving fees for new businesses because it's an entry barrier for entrepreneurs. Yeah. And, you know, there's a lot of angles to this that need to be examined, and, you know, and that's what we have an opportunity to do now that people are involved.
So I'm still a little leery of ways for city to raise revenue.
Duncan and Dennis and the officer, I just wanted to tell you guys thank you. Like, I'm really proud that you guys.
Okay, we're not trying to shove this down.
I'm happy that you're flexible to change, that you were there to listen to us, and that you want to represent the people, because like that's the most important thing. So I just want to thank you. Punk rock and metal community in this city, and I know that these shows are loud. I mean, it's rock music. It's going to be loud. But honestly, we're not bad people, and we do not want to like just make it hard for anybody to sleep or make anybody annoyed. We just want to have our little scene. We just want to have a place where we can be ourselves. We're not scary people. I just wanted to put that out there that we want to be involved in this too. And we don't. I mean, I speak for myself, but I want to be involved with this. I don't want to ruin anybody's evening, but I want the scene to stay vibrant within Whiteaker community.
Yeah. I thought we put a ordinance for a decibel level per genre.
I recommend an ordinance that it sort of gives more leeway to certain, you know, to certain areas, kind of like, you know, the core of the Whiteaker. Maybe that needs more leeway than what you have, you know, 10 blocks away.
That's a good point.
And little, this thing can be whatever this group creates and can get city council to approve.
Yeah. Which is challenging.
If this many people show up, it won't be challenging.
Yeah.
Well, you know, maybe I can talk to you about some other costumes. Yeah. The problem is they didn't sign up.
All right, next.
So I'm the vice president of the Jesco Club, and we have had live music. We have gone to our neighbors and addressed their concerns before, and even had them come and give us feedback. I gave him my cell phone number so that if it got too loud. And we have one relationship with the church right next door that has elderly people living behind it. And so we've gone out and been proactive in that. And I like loud music as much as the next guy, but just by taking a little bit of action to where I made sure that the people that it was going to bother were not, wasn't scaring little old ladies at 10 or 11 o'clock at night with loud rock music. We get along very well with them.
Did they reciprocate? Though I lived right next door to the church that you're talking about. Right next door. They and their bells ring at such grand.
You know, getting back to the metal, I don't think a metal band should at ever any time be louder than the train.
At the train.
Everybody, please make sure to sign in on that clipboard that's still circulating. I don't know where it went.
So
let's go hang out back there.
So I have some other stuff to do, but I was so So to recap, we are going to meet here in 2 weeks, and after having studied and talked about the issues amongst ourselves, and
sure.
Yeah, that's what yeah. we're doing.
Well, the clear for the board, if someone wants to stand for the board seat.
But yeah, you can nominate yourself. You just need some of the second you can nominate and second yourself. Or someone else can nominate you.
Is there a list of the seats that
are up? We will first vote for and elect a chair who will then take over as chair. And carry on from there during the rest. Usually then we do the vice chair, the treasurer, the secretary, and then there's just open board seats up to 15 people on the board. So as many as 11 other people if they want to do it. Right now I think we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Well, 7 we're technically on the board, although Paul is kind of giving up and so is Dan. So, I mean, this is it. This is 5 people on the board. And that's all we have.
I'm not running.
And she's not running.
I'm not running. So.
And he's not running. So.
I'm moving. Yeah. And you?
I certainly do not want to be chair. Look at this, I'm saying. I have to be on the board. Although, I'll be available to anyone who wants to.
I think you're killing it.
I'll
vote for you in another place. I'll
vote for you.
I'll find out more about the and what they require.
Hey, Duncan, can you do a favor and send mail out to bylaws to people so sure. Everyone can look at it before the team shows
up? Yeah. Yeah. There's a couple of copies going around. Yeah. Is there also, is there a place to access them online?
They are on the website.
Okay. Eugene website.
Good. I have them all. It's WhiteakerCommunityCouncil.com. It's long. Sorry, it's .org. Go there and look at the
Rockies, man. Whiteaker people can't spell that much.
I know you can spell.
Whiteaker's hard to spell.
This page, plus your documents page, and all the documents are actually right there.
Yeah, if you give your email address, I'll email you a copy of the noise bit and the bylaws. Although, other than, having been to a meeting,
Can you send out an email? Can you send out a copy of the email list to people too, so that people have an opportunity to stay? Because right now we have a lot of people together.
Normally, unless there's somebody on the board or a public person,
What you could do is start your own sign-up list in the door to
get
either contact on
the way out. Yeah, you start a Facebook group or something like that. Start the fan page for the elections.
So that's my question, my next question, pardon me for a second. So does somebody have to be nominated tonight or
I'll deal in 2 weeks.
I think that's right.
And if you have more thing you want to add? Alright, if there's no objections, can we adjourn?
No. The young lady that wants to do this a presentation
of the
building.
I'm sorry.
And please clarify, is the election going to be here or is it going to be in the auditorium?
It will either be here, but we have this room, gentlemen.
Normally we have it from the second and third Wednesday.
No, I can do them across the board.
Free is another
side.
You want to ride?
We'll be sending out an email saying,
So just so everyone knows, for future reference, I'm out a lot at 2nd and Jackson. It's outdoors, but for events or meetings like this, if we can't get into the auditorium or gym, and it's sunny outside with enough notice, we can use that lot at the corner of 2nd and Jackson.
What
about the noise, though?
The train is way loud.
You know what
we
can
do? We can do with other events. That's hand out flyers to the neighbors and invite them. And
if you care,
chat.
Can I
get that really quickly?
Next. Don't get me.
All right, so we're going to do the election in 2 weeks. We're going to do noise again in 2 weeks. And I guess we still have parking on there?
That's it.
The parking is 2 weeks. And now we have some of the buses.
Okay, well, I can give you a report on what we have been doing.
Thanks.
There's been a lot of
interest
in the parking permit program. So,
it's the people in the planning department that are allowing this to happen.
If I may, I dealt with this issue extensively because of the bars and stuff on that strip. Ninkasi and the Blair Alley Arcade are outside of the Whiteaker parking exempt zone. And so I am in a situation now where I rent parking that I'm never going to use from Tiny's Tavern just to have my occupancy. Talked pretty sensitive to Sarah, a lot of folks, and they're very aware that they've created this. And the furthest I've gotten with them was a gentleman's neighbor down somewhere. He wanted me to start going around soliciting some of the big lot owners.
You want me to sign that?
Let them know that if they were to, in some way, use their lot for parking, which is a mess in and of itself, because they have something to do with parking. But that they would consider getting permitted and leaving property taxes for those areas. So there's a bunch of like small little areas, like the area right behind the gas station at 6th and Blair. There's a property, Roscoe Divide over there on the lot adjacent to Red Apple. And quite a few others that are just empty grass lots.
The 10 lots have been rented by the Costco.
Which one?
That happened.
From Roscoe?
They were required to rent a certain amount of space from the parking.
Oh, wait,
and they rented that space from Roscoe.
Right, no longer, because they built all their own parking. So Roscoe was looking to do something with an hour of parking. So
he
would
get a tax property tax.
Right, and it would be up to us to promote that lot.
And the city would assume the insurance law.
Probably not. No. And in fact, I was told pretty pointedly that would be as far as they could extend it, and that effectively you'd have to establish some kind of entity to actually run the parking lot, whether it was, you know, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Now we're talking. Job or two, some people that
don't
like to hang out down there.
Whoa, there you go.
Stations for parking, we had nobody wants to pay parking lots, but it's got to be for something. Maybe if we had some parking lot. Okay, you're lucky, but it's not. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah,
that's
what I'm
saying. Oh, sure.
We at Blair Alley actually start going to public hearings. It's an alley,
it's Gerald.
I can say it's in trouble now.
Collected and fermented. It has many uses.
Has everybody signed in?
Everybody get their name on the paper. We're doing it now.
It's still going.
Yeah, we got one back here.
Well, there's many different things.
I have.
Sure.
What's the deal with it? It's
all right.
What's brought people out?
Yeah.
The noise ordinance.
And what's the difference?
Oregon, I'm in the Department of Landscape Architecture. My focus is urban design. I'm doing my master's project on livability and how urban design affects whether a place is perceived as livable. So I'm looking at elements like parking and building heights and physical materiality. So paving patterns, textures, planters, all these elements which may influence if you're in a space, whether you feel comfortable, whether you feel safe, whether your well-being is enhanced. And so I have created this online survey to get feedback from your community. So livability is unique for every community, every city, every individual. And I would really love to have feedback from this very engaged group. So if you wouldn't mind signing up, you could just put your email down. It's an online survey. It's at your leisure. And that would be great. If there are any questions, please come talk to me. So, thank you so much.
As her fellow classmate, I think this is a great opportunity for just graduate students like ourselves that are proposing this kind of design, because if we can work with the community here now, I mean, take advantage of us students that we're proposing to engage the community and take these surveys. We just want to make sure we work with Eugene as well, not some, you know, East Coast or some site outside. So I just want to thank you for work that
And we run out of room, sweetie. Do you have any more pages?
Oh. Buy some sort of merchandise, and that merchandise, 100% of the net profits will go to charities locally. Also, community events that need funding that you guys can all get a hold of me and let me know where, hey, some money needs to go here. Me, like I said, I'm a fifth generation Oregonian. If you're that long here, you know that I've been living for pretty much my whole life. So money to me doesn't really matter. So giving away and giving back to the kids, you know, my son goes right here at EC Cares, early childhood prevention for autism. Also, like Archibald County is something we need to be helping out with. From the first day we opened. So my email's on there. It's b.woodruff@manfieldbrewingcompany.com. If there's anything that you guys know personally that needs a little extra boost, you know, when we open, not now, when we open, let us know.
Is that that warehouse by American Tire?
It is, right behind the brown one. Yeah. And right across, just we're talking about parking and stuff like that. Right across from us, there's a huge lot there, a business. There's like a construction type business that's gone under. And so now there's a huge open lot. It's literally the size of, from 6th Street to 5th Street, right by GJ's restaurant. And it's going to be wide open. So,
Lane Forest Park.
Central Lane.
Some sort of.
Oh, Central Lane?
Central Lane.
Yeah.
Central Lane.
So, yeah, they're going. Yeah. So, their parking lot is going to be.
I got a curious question. You know, I know that like the winter nowadays is the brewery district, and I know that I personally can smell. All my friends who grow pot,
yeah,
have like ozonators, things like that, so you can't smell when you grow pot.
Right.
They do. That's fact. We live here. We live down here.
And it's legal.
Oh, it's legal, of course. It's legal. And so, but they, you know, they have this capability. This technology is all there.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
What makes it so? Why can't breweries basically do the same thing? I mean,
well, I think they could definitely.
Yeah, just throwing it out there. It's not it.
For me, you know, I'm a self-funded guy. I bartended for 10 years and saved like almost all my tips. Get me to where I would be. So like for me to get something like that in there would be super hard for me to do, like funding wise, unless, you know, it'd just be more bureaucracy for me to try to do that, because I know me personally, I don't have money.
I don't think that's really directed at you. I think that's directed at someone.
Oh, just in general, yeah.
That's what you have when you talk.
But
until you get well established, and then.
Yeah, no. Even then, I mean, like another thing we're doing is looking at your 2 mile radius, which from our building, which is like at the west end of the width, all the way downtown, like, which is 2 miles, like mile and a half. We're doing all like local delivery on bike. We're all like bike guys. So that's another thing we're doing. We're doing it three of the, you know, seasons out there. I'm not going to do it during the wintertime. For me, that's my carbon footprint that I'm trying to help out with. We come back to what you're talking about earlier. It does a lot of CO2 in the air and all that stuff from the calories. Yeah.
Since we're doing like introductions, I'm Nicole, and I'm on May 1st. I'm taking over management of Raven Moon Emporium, just right here on First. We're going to carry mostly local gifts and locally made products, and we're also a full service florist. So you guys should come and check it out. It's going to be awesome. And if you guys make stuff, come find me. So I'm all fine. I know the wit like some makes stuff.
It's a grass place. Sorry,
that's it.
I pay your neighbor in
across from our house.
What's that?
Not a free brewery.
Well, we wanted to be a nonprofit originally, you know, a nonprofit brewery.
I think I lost my time. I can't even visualize.
23.
Jesus.
Investing, he wants to have a return. So my way of still having some sort of society based, you know. And it's literally anything from one of these dollar bracelets that we make, where 50 cents goes, or a shirt, you know, that's $12 ago to charity. So I mean, yeah, seriously.
Get off it!
Yeah, like.
I get back on the table.
I have people pointing on my porch every single time I get there. And, you know, I have the police officers call me up, you know, a couple different times. Hey, is there somebody on your porch? Are you okay with that? I drive a cab on weekends now. So I'll drive by there in the cab and say, hey, buddy, you doing okay? Yeah, okay, you're not too drunk, you're not going to hurt yourself. Cool, man, have fun, you know. Be okay. Try not to poop on the lawn, you know. Those kinds of things.
Use the book of Bill.
That's where I started brewing back in like 2005. I, I live there, and we I lived in a little shack. So, like, that's where I started brewing at. Been having a lot of love for this community. Yeah, absolutely. This one, this little corner.
Here, are we closing them?
All right, any other before we go announcements? Anybody? No? Good. Then we're...
This is quick. Summer's here. Very terrible. You may know that property crime is a big problem in Eugene. Because there are so many people here, it's going to take 30 seconds to tell you, please, don't leave valuables in your cars. I know that's inconvenient sometimes, but cars are not safe for anything. We have a problem to start that rate. Burglaries. Burglary rate is off the charts, and I'm here to tell you that 80% of them are unlocked dwellings. Please, lock your doors and windows. It only takes a minute. Yes, I know the house gets stuffy, but when you're gone, and even at night when you're home, much safer to have them locked up. Keep your stuff, keep people from coming in while you're there. That's it, that's my safety message for the day. Oh, and we sell clubs for $12.50. We've got a car that might be stolen and you want to buy a cheap steering wheel lock. Come down to the clubs and sell you one.
Okay, so there's the sign up over here. And we're sure.